Hello, I'm Paul Wakim. I'm Chief of Biostatistics and Clinical Epidemiology Service at the NIH Clinical Center, and this is the last part, part five, of the module on hypothesis testing. And in this segment, we're going to talk about two topics that are kind of important, and I thought I'll mention them very briefly, and that's what we're going to go over: the superiority, non-inferiority, and equivalence tests, and the multiple comparisons, also called multiplicity adjustment. So let's get started. Superiority. When we talk about superiority, we really mean going either way. So even if you're talking about medication and placebo, we call it a two-sided, it's superiority, it's a two-sided. So it's possible that the medication would be better than placebo, or we allow the placebo to be better than medication. So, in superiority, the clinical hypothesis is that the experimental treatment is more effective than the control treatment, and or the other way, theoretically. But we're hoping that the experimental is going to be more effective. That's the clinical hypothesis. So when would we do a superiority trial is when we want to find that the new medication is better than placebo or better than treatment as usual. The statistical hypothesis, in more technical terms, the null hypothesis is that the experimental is equal to the control, and the alternative hypothesis is that the experimental is different from the control. So again, we allow it either way. And we expect or hope to reject the null hypothesis in favor of the alternative. We are hoping that the new medication is going to be better than the old or than the placebo. So here's a kind of an illustration of what we're talking about. So if the difference is zero, that means no difference. Basically, on the right is good outcome. And I'm going to show you confidence, 95% confidence interval around the difference. So we're talking about difference here. And zero difference means no difference. So you look at the confidence, you do your clinical trial, you get the confidence interval, and if you get a confidence interval that's to the right of zero, then you call it superior. Again, remember we talked about clinically minimum important difference, and keeping that aside for a minute. But in this context, if it is to the right of zero, we say it is superior. If it is to the left of zero, we say it's inferior, or we say the placebo is superior. And if it covers zero, it's inconclusive. And so these are the four possibilities that we can see in superiority trials. In non-inferiority trials, the experimental treatment is not less effective than the control treatment. So, for example, a typical example is generic drugs. We want to show that the generic drug is not less effective than the brand drug. Or a very similar drug is not less effective than an approved drug. And that's when we would do a non-inferiority trial. The statistical hypothesis is that the null hypothesis is that the experimental is less than the control minus delta. So delta now is this difference that makes it, if it is within the difference is within delta, we say, well, the difference is not really that big. We can assume it's the same if it is within less than this delta. Delta is called the non-inferiority, the margin, non-inferiority margin. So if it is within that delta, we say it's pretty much the same, or it's not less inferior. But if it is the difference is more than that, then we say it is inferior. So the alternative is that the experimental is greater than the control minus delta. And again, we expect and hope to reject H0 in favor of the alternative. And in here, we have the delta at zero, and we also have the delta at the minus, the big delta as capital delta, as at minus little delta, the non-inferiority margin. And so what we're saying is, if the confidence interval is above zero, we say it's superior, fine. And if it is below the minus delta, we say it's inferior. because it's less than the control by an important difference, which is the little delta. But if the confidence interval is still on the right of the minus delta, we say it's non-inferior. If it covers everything, it says an inconclusive. But now, think about it this way. It is, the confidence interval is completely to the left of zero, but completely to the right of minus delta. The conclusion is it's non-inferior, because we started the trial saying, you know, if the difference is within the small delta, it's still just as effective. So that's called non-inferior. The question mark is, although, is because, you know, the whole confidence interval is to the left of zero. And if it covers the minus delta, we say it's inconclusive, although the whole confidence interval is to the left of zero. So these are the possibilities in non-inferiority trials. Equivalence trials say the experimental treatment is just as effective as the control treatment. So we have two therapies or two medications, and we want to do comparative effectiveness research. And we want to show that, are they pretty much the same, as effective as each other? You know, are they as effective? That's really what we're asking. In statistical terms, the null hypothesis says that the experimental is either clearly worse or clearly better. That's the null. But the alternative is that the experimental is within a range of minus to plus delta, and they are about as effective. And it doesn't matter which one, if we have experimental and control or just two medications. And we hope to reject H0 in favor of the alternative. And so here we have the zero of no difference, but we have a minus delta and a plus delta. And if the confidence interval is within the minus delta and delta, we say they're just about as effective. The two treatments are just about as effective. So this is equivalent. This is equivalent. It has a question mark because it says even though it's clearly to the right or to the left of zero, it's still considered equivalent. To the right, completely to the right is superior. Completely to the left is inferior. And if it covers several thresholds, it's inconclusive. It's also inconclusive if it covers the minus delta threshold and the plus delta, even though it's completely to the right or to the left of zero. And so these are the possible conclusions. Okay, so that's for superiority, non-inferiority, and equivalence tests. I want to now switch to a completely different topic. And that's multiplicity adjustment. And the first time I heard this analogy with the dartboard is from Michael Prochain, who is also a biostatistician and at NIH. He made this analogy with multiplicity, the dartboard game with the multiplicity adjustment. So here's the analogy. Think of two players playing this game. And you have player one that starts to throw darts at this board. And this is what happens. So the player one comes and throws darts. And this is what he hits these places. Okay? And then after 20 shots, he hits the bullseye. After 20 shots, he hits the bullseye. That's player one. Then comes player two. And after one shot, hits the bullseye. Would you say that player one is just as good at this game as player two? They both eventually hit the bullseye. But would you say they're as good at this game as each other? I would think no. The first one, it took him or her 20 shots to hit the bullseye. The second one, just after one shot, hit the bullseye. It's the same idea with multiplicity adjustment. Remember I told you There are two ways to get small p-values guaranteed. And one way was just to increase the sample size, and eventually you'll get a small p-value. Well, the second way is just keep on trying different statistical tests with different assessments, with different subgroups. Keep on trying test, statistical test, and eventually you're going to find a small p-value. So you're just going to throw darts, and eventually, just by pure luck or chance, you're going to hit the bullseye. But doesn't mean that you have really an important finding. So in the words of Motulsky, who is an author who writes in very plain English statistical concept, he basically says in these two books, if you calculate many p-values, some are likely to be small just by random chance. Therefore, it is impossible to interpret small p-values without knowing how many comparisons were made. If you make 13 independent comparisons with all null hypotheses true, in other words, if you make 13 independent comparisons with no difference, there is about a 50% chance that one or more p-values will be less than 0.05, that you will find is statistically significant. It goes back to remember those diagrams with the 1,000 clinical trials. Eventually, some of them are going to be statistically significant. Same idea. So with multiple comparison, it's easy to be misled by small p-values. So what does it mean to do a multiplicity adjustment? To do a multiplicity adjustment means you have to adjust the p-value to account for the multiple tests that you have done. So basically, you have to raise the p-value that you got or lower the threshold. But since we're getting away from threshold, you have to raise the p-value. So situation that need multiplicity adjustment is if you have multiple endpoints, multiple time points, subgroups, geographical areas, predictions, geographical groups, ways to select variables in multiple regression, methods of pre-processing data, and multiple statistical analysis. All of these are examples where you need multiplicity adjustment. When you do basically several tests, whatever those tests are, you need to adjust for multiplicity. So here's an example. If you have two endpoints, drug use and retention. So these are two endpoints. They're both important in illicit drug treatment. Drug use, you want to lower drug use and you want to keep retention high. Each endpoint is tested at the 5% alpha level. The experimental treatment is considered beneficial if either or both endpoints are significant. So without multiplicity adjustment, if you don't do this adjustment, the chance of the treatment being found beneficial when it is not, type 1 error, can be as high as 10%, not 5%, because either one of those two endpoints have to be significant. So, multiplicity adjustment is a way to control for false positive conclusions, claiming you've got a positive results when you don't. It's a way to control the family-wise or study-wise rate of false positive conclusion. So the keywords are family-wise or study-wise. So, when do you do multiplicity adjustment? When is it necessary? This is my personal opinion now. You do it formally using methods that there are many, many methods for adjusting p-values, and they have their pluses and minuses. So that's formally. Whenever there are more than one primary endpoint, so it's a primary endpoint, there are several and more than two treatment conditions, more than one dose versus placebo, or more than one time point. So I'm going to give you an example of when it is needed because it's the primary analysis. It's the main objective, the purpose of the trial. And this is, if you look at the abstract of this paper, it says the primary purpose is objective, is to test the effectiveness of two interventions compared to usual care in decreasing attitudinal barriers to cancer pain management, decreasing pain intensity, and improving functional status and quality of life. So right there, the primary objective of the clinical trial is to do two interventions versus usual care, okay? And then you've got four primary endpoints: decreasing attitudinal barriers to cancer pain management, decreasing pain intensity, improving functional status and quality of life. So in this case, because it's a primary analysis, you need to do it formally. Informally, whenever there are more than one secondary analysis, including subgroup analysis. So when you're doing secondary analysis, subgroup analysis, again, it's my personal opinion. The way I like to do it when it is informal, what I mean by informal, you basically tell the reader in the paper, you know, look, we're obviously from this table, you can see, remember that table with so many subgroups? And you basically highlight the fact that you've done a lot of subgroup analysis. Here are the confidence interval, here are the p-values, but kind of warn the reader that these p-values have to really mentally be adjusted. In other words, if you're really gonna use a threshold, which you shouldn't, lower the threshold, make it harder to, if you see a p-value of 0.03, when you've done 20 tests, don't take it too seriously. I mean, that's the bottom line. So when is multiplicity adjustment not necessary? When all the primary endpoints have to be statistically significant in order to claim treatment benefit, e.g. to get FDA approval. Again, this is a recommendation from the European agency in 2002, which is way, way before the ASA 2019 recommendation. It talks about statistically significant. And it goes back also to the point that we need to make changes to the thinking, institutional changes. And the example of the previous example, we say the experimental treatment is considered beneficial only if both illicit drug use reduction and retention are found to be statistically significant. If that's, you need both to claim efficacy or effectiveness, then you don't need to do a multiplicity adjustment. So here are the references. In summary, as in a superiority trial, the objective is to show that one treatment is more effective than another. In a non-inferiority trial, the objective is to show that one treatment is not less effective than another. In an equivalence trial, the objective is to show that two treatments are not too different in effectiveness. And multiplicity adjustment is a way to control for overall false positive conclusions. And my questions to you is, when is multiplicity adjustment necessary? Why is multiplicity adjustment necessary? And when is multiplicity adjustment not necessary? Thank you for watching.